Hello guys, my name is Kiki, and yes, this is the first time when I show my face on camera. I'm a little bit shy, but I thought it's maybe more personal if I show myself. So in this video, I'm going to show you how I replace this laboratory power supply, which is a relatively big one, with this one. Basically fits onto my hands easily. For sure this is not as professional as this big one. You cannot really earth the device you are working on, like on this one, but anyway, I usually only work on battery power devices, like on Nintendo Switches and USB devices and things like this. So it's not really a problem, and I can tell you I have never used this earthing connection on this one. And then due to the reason that I have a really limited space, I'm working basically in our bedroom, and I only have a table here, and I have a small drawer behind me. This is my only storage. So for me, this is usually hidden inside a drawer quite deeply, and it's a pain to remove it there. It consumes a lot of space on my table. So I was looking around online, and I could find basically this one. I mean, only the what you can see inside the frame, this display. This is nothing else at the end, like a DC-DC converter, which is able to work in both constant voltage and constant current generator mode. This is really cool, because this is all what you need if you are looking to find a short on your device, for example, or if you want to charge a battery or things like this. And basically it's powered with a 90 watt HP laptop power supply. It's pretty simple. There is a magnet on here on the bottom. This way I can put it nicely on the top of my Aten hotel station. I will show a picture soon how it looks like when everything is in place. And then you can use either a multimeter connector to connect here to power your devices when you really need some fine tips, or you can use banana plugs and these small little hooks to connect up your device. Okay, so in this video I'm going to show you how I built this one. Basically, as I told, I bought this little unit with a nice LCD on Amazon. I designed and 3D printed the frame, and basically just wired it up with a DC jack connector on the back and with a switch, and that's it. And I 3D printed the case. So I will switch over to my overhead camera and I will show you what is this all about. Okay, so just to show a closer look of this, this is really just a 3D printed case, this little frame, DC-DC unit embedded into this frame, two the banana plugs, one switch, which is a power switch, and a DC jack at the back. And what I forgot to tell you, that this device is able to work up to 50 volts and 5 amps. I'm, to be honest, not really sure, or I would say I'm absolutely sure it's not able to work on 50 volt and 5 amps, because it would be 250 watts, which is for sure way too much for this device, I think. But anyway, I'm using it from this laptop power supply, so it's able to go up to 20 volts and roughly 4 amps, which is more than enough for my application, basically. It's, as you can tell, it's really small. It's just barely bigger than my mouse. In length it's even smaller. And as I told, there is a huge magnet on the bottom, so I can just sit it on top of my hot air station, and it just does not move, because it's quite lightweight. So you could just move it all around or drag it all around with the cables, but this way it works perfectly fine. This huge magnet holds it really tight. So let me take it apart. Basically, there are four for Allen screws holding it together. And basically that's all. As you can see, there is the DC input. I used all blue cables because that's all what I had at home. So from the DC input, from the plus, it goes to the switch, and then from the switch it goes to this connector here. I can also remove this. So you have the DC plus and minus, and then you have these are the inputs, and then you have the plus and minus output. Here the two cables goes to the output, banana jacks, and basically I can just push it out from the case, and that's all. This is for the connector. This green connector connects to, and you can see here this input plus minus and output plus minus, and it's nothing else really, like just like this. It's really simple, but I have to tell, it works really really well. Let me show you the listing. I did not tell this to you. This costs roughly 43 euro, and yeah, for sure I do not count anything for my 3D printing because I can do it myself. It took me roughly 2 hours to print the case itself, and roughly 30 minutes to design it. And yeah, at the end you only need a DC jack and a switch and a few cables and the banana connectors here. So it's really recommended to use relatively thick gauged cables, because then you do not really have a voltage drop on the cables itself. So it means that if you set here 20 volts, then you will not have a voltage drop on the cable itself, and you will measure on the outputs also 20 volts. So there is only a really, really minor voltage drop, because basically this cable has almost zero resistance in this length and in this thickness. So let me show you the Amazon listing. So I just did a print screen from Amazon. This is for today. So it, as you can see, it costs 44.5 euro roughly, and it's able to handle 50 volt 5 amps. As I told, I'm quite confident that not both the same time, so it cannot really handle 250 watts with such a tiny heatsink and so on. Though it's a DC-DC converter, with high switching frequency, so it works way more efficiently like a linear power supply, but I have still doubts that this is still able to deliver this. But it can easily handle the 20 volt and 4 amps what I'm using it on, and it's more than enough for 99% of my applications. So it's quite decent. I think it's quite nicely priced. It's not an expensive device. And then I just designed really the 3D printing unit, 3D printed case, and I just soldered it together in 10 minutes, and that's it. So let me show you how it works. So I connect it back together first. At first I have to put it into the frame. It just fits in nicely, and then now from the back I have to connect up the cable, the connector. Okay, and let's put back the case, the back cover. Okay, and it's ready. So let's connect it up and let me show you how it works. So it shows voltage, shows the current draw, and also calculating the power, the delivered power. And it also shows the input voltage. Here you can see that from my HP notebook power supply, 19.97 volts is coming into the device. So basically this, or slightly lower than this voltage, is my max voltage, because this is a DC-DC buck converter, so it's only able to create lower voltages, like the input voltage. It's not a boost regulator, but for me 20 volt is more than enough. And whenever I want, I can connect up a higher voltage, a 48 volt power supply or something like this, and then I'm able to use almost the entire range of this device. As you can see here, it shows the set voltage and the set current. Here, the last time when I used it, and it's a pretty nice feature, it's saving, even if you turn it off, it's saving the last settings. So I used it for finding shorts, so injecting voltage. So I injected 0.7 volts and 3.6 amps. It was already the end of the story. With relatively high current, because I did not have a direct short, so I had to do this. There is a rotary encoder, and basically this on-off switch is basically turning on your output. So as you can see, as soon as I push this button, the voltage jumped up to 0.7 volts. So basically you are turning on the output with this button. It's also a pretty nice feature. It's not directly turned on, so as soon as I connect it up, you are not sparking while you are connecting it up. You can connect up the device to the unit you want to check or you want to power with, and then you press the button and the voltage is nicely going up. So what I also checked, and which is also really important in case of such a unit, I measured and I hooked it up to my oscilloscope while measuring some shorts, and I look for the overshoot. So when you usually switch on a power supply like this, if it's a really cheap, crappy one, then you might end up with significant overshoots. Whatever this means, you set up, for example, 10 volts or just 0.7 volt or whatever you want to set, and the voltage at the beginning when you turn it on will rise up to a way higher level, and only then it goes down. So, and with this, you can basically kill several devices. You can kill your device under test with this. Let me show you the oscilloscope capture, what I did on the switching periods, and I have to tell you, it's really, really good. So here is one of them. Here I set, I do not remember already, I set, I think, 17 volts, and as you can see here, this little spike, and at the bottom it's maximum 7.9 volt. So whatever it means, that as soon as I touch the cable, because I tried it both ways, that I touched the cable while the output was already turned on, and here you can see that I have only 0.9 volt overshoot, which is really great. And I repeated it two times. And also when disconnecting it, there is only a really, really low negative voltage here. And let's show you the other one. And this type, whatever I did, I connected up the probes already to the device. I mean the device under test. And this case, I turned on the power supply with the button, with the on-off button that I showed you, which is turning on the output. And here this was 1.2 volt what I set, and as you can see this way, you have the voltage is nicely slowly ramping up, and you have basically zero overshoot, which is amazing. So especially when you are testing something like a CPU or something like this, some critical areas, or I mean on CPU rails or really low voltage rails, if you have a few volt overshoot, you could immediately kill your CPU basically. But here this is really recommended, that at first you connect it up to the device and then you turn it on with the on-off button itself, and then it's nicely slowly ramping up and reaching the setting voltage. Okay, what I still wanted to show you, I will just show it to you, that it really works nicely. you can go into the with the set button to the settings. Oh, sorry, with set, and you go here, and then if you once press on the encoder button, then you select the first digit here, and you set the voltage. For example, now I want to set 3.3 volt, and I set 3 volt at first. I press on again, and then I go down to 3.3 and press on, and the last digit is fine. And setting up the current is the same. So at first I set the first digit. So let's set 1 amp, for example. And that's it. So now output is set to 3.3 volt. And 1 amp current limit, and as soon as basically no the it was already turned on, but as you can see, if it's turned off, then you do not have voltage. This always shows the output voltage, and if I turn it on, then now I have 3.31 volt, which is perfect. It's only 10 millivolt off, which is great. And let me show you if I short it, then it's nicely setting 1 amps. Okay, it's 2 milliamps off, which is great. And what I can still show you, as you can see, it's also calculating the power draw, which is 15 milliwatts in this case, which is nothing basically. And then let me show you how accurate it is. Connecting it up to my multimeter, and as you can see, the thread voltage is 3.31, and I measured the exact same on the multimeter, which is amazing. It's really nice. Okay guys, so that's it for this video. I hope you liked it. I think this is a really, really nice little unit. I'm so happy that I replaced that huge power supply with this one. For sure this has slightly limited functions compared to the other one, but for most of our application for repairs, this is more than enough. And I'm not working in the highest precision levels, but as you could see, it's also quite precise and accurate. I also checked the current setting of this with the multimeter, and this is also quite correct. So I can really recommend this. I will put in the description the Amazon listing for this little device. So if you want to build one yourself, then you can just buy it. And as you can see, it's pretty simple, really just three connectors and a switch and a case, and that's it. So, okay guys, I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you found this helpful. If yes, please don't forget to like the video, subscribe to my channel, and I hope I see you next time. Bye.